Om Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shanti
We'll chant Ishavasya Upanishad mantras 9 till the end.
Andham tamah pravishanti ye vidyam upasate tato bhuya ivate tamoya uvidyaya gurataha anya deva hur vidyaya anya dahura vidyaya इति शुश्रुमधीराणां येनस्तद्विचचक्षिरे विद्यां च यस्तद्वेदो भयगो सह अविद्यया मृत्युं तीर्त्वा विद्यया मृतमश्नुते अंधं तमः प्रविशन्ति ये सम्भूतिमुपासते ततो भूय इव ते तमोय उसम्भूत्यागुरताः अन्यदेवाहुः सम्भवादन्यदाहुरसम्भवात् इति शुश्रुमधीराणां येनस्तद्विचचक्षिरे सम्भूतिं च विनाशं च यस्तद्वेदो भयगो सः विनाशेन मृत्युं तीर्त्वा सम्भूत्यामृतमश्नुते हिरण्मयेन पात्रेण सत्यस्यापि हितं मुखम् तत्त्वं पूषन्न पावृणु सत्यधर्माय दृष्टये पूषन्नेकर्षे यमसूर्यप्राजापत्यव्यूहरश्मीन् समूहते ज्योयत्ते रूपं कल्याणतमं तत्ते पश्यामि यो सावसौ पुरुषः सोऽहमस्मि वायुरनिलममृतमथेदं भस्मान्तगुं शरीरम् ॐ क्रतो स्मर कृतगो स्मर क्रतो स्मर कृतगो स्मर अग्नेनय सुपथाराये अस्मान् विश्वानि देव वयुनानि विद्वान् युयोध्यस्मज्जुहुराणमे नो भूयिष्ठां ते नम उक्तिं विधेम
मंत्रस 15 16 एंड 17 ड्रामेटाइजेस व्हाट एक्चुअल सेल्फ रियलाइजेशन इज इट इज गिवन इन थ्री स्टेजेस Mantra 15 talks about the first stage where the seeker with all his efforts who has come to the verge of self-realization, so sort of with a commanding tone he says, remove that golden disc which is covering, I want to see, I want to behold thee. This is his prayer in the 15th verse. So the golden disc there is, we saw in the last class that the golden disc represents the last thought. So it is like a person who has paid all the price that is required for what he has to ultimately get. And there is one thing that is finally not really obstructing, that has to be removed so that he has to merge with that. So with that commanding tone he says, I am eligible for that, therefore please remove. And sun here is represented, is representing the self, and the golden disc represents the last thought. the disc is golden because final thought is the thought of the divinity only. And therefore, it is not indicated as something ignorance. In Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says, Dharma viruddho bhuteshu kamosmi paratarshava. I am that desire in you which is not opposed to dharma. From the ultimate point of view, the interpretation is that the thought of self in you is me only. Everything in our system is related to vasanas, but there are certain aspects that we explain are aspects of the self functioning in us. The conscience, we say, is the voice of God, as it were, functioning. The self effort or purushartha is the manifestation of the infinite in you. Like that, the thought of the self is that which will be the last, because having put in effort to remove all other thoughts, what finally remains is this one only. And we said that the last thought going away is not in our hands. That is why slokas like Moksha Ishyami Mashuchaha, all these are guaranteed by somebody that he will be able to remove that last thought and take us to liberation. So that is the command that he is saying, that I have come up to this point, which is the maximum can be done by a sadhak. Now it is up to you to remove that golden disc and reveal yourself. In the 16th mantra, obliging to his prayer, the golden disc is removed. The last thought is removed, and as though he is plunging into infinite. And that is a supernatural experience, or you can't even say it is experience, it is beyond it all, which for a moment he is not able to take it, which he is not able to cope with. Therefore he says, gather all their dazzle, please take it, you know. And for a moment he says that, and then he stabilizes himself and says, at the third stage, now I am able to see you, soham asmi, I am he, there he is established. So the comparison of this experience, there is a parallel in Bhagavad Gita, is that of Arjuna's experience, where he asks for Vishwarupa, which is equivalent or symbolic of this only. But since he is not a fully prepared mumukshu type of a student like this Upanishad student, when the Supreme Form reveals itself in a varying magnitudes, and finally when it shows the all endeavoring kala, or the ultimate death, he is not able to take it. So he asks the form to pacify itself and reveal in a form of Chaturbhuja Vishnu or four-handed Lord Vishnu. The lesson at the practical level is that even at the spiritual level, even during our sadhana, we should not try to absorb something which is much beyond our capacity at that point of time. Ultimately, we must aspire for self-realization. There is no doubt about it. Just as a child cannot eat, let us say, a full apple fruit or something like that. It has its capacity to eat and digest. So the mother knows how much it needs and she will feed. Exactly like that, however much you may want and desire and you want it immediately, having got inspired about self or self-realization, it has to be in proper dosage and proper stages as far as the sadhana is concerned. But never, definitely we should not get complacent at any stage and stay put there. We have to strive and move forward. And then once you are fully ready, you will be able to take it. So this is what is indicated here. And as we discussed in the last class, this actual experience of self-realization has no equivalent in any way that it can be conveyed. Though the dream example and other examples are there to say what it is, but we really cannot experience. Even the experience from dream to waking state is just a change in degree. You are experiencing more or less similar things in the dream, and you are experiencing similar things in the waking world. So this is a difference in degree, but self-realization is different in kind. So that is something like the example again given here is how the river enters the ocean. All the path, miles and miles that rivers has crossed, and every experience of the river has no equivalent of how it is merging with the ocean. And the merging with the ocean has if we can extend that example a little further, you will find, in fact, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa says this, I think, there are some rivers where you can very clearly see how it goes and enters the ocean, some particularly small rivers. In South Africa also, when we saw, it's a river and you can very clearly see how it goes into the ocean. But if you imagine a river like Ganga, can you really say where is the exact point where Ganga ends and ocean begins? It is before that itself, Ganga acquires the property of ocean, as it were. So, he says, as the river approaches the ocean is actually expecting and waiting. So, it goes ahead and embraces the river. So, it is further coming inside and swallowing the ocean, as it were. This is actually the equivalent of the infinite swallowing the finite. So, once the finite is dissolved, there is no more properties of that river. It is individuality in its particular way is gone. It has gained the totality of the ocean. Ocean is one and it is infinite everywhere. Though you have rivers like Krishna or Godavari or various rivers having their specific color, specific property, specific taste, all this gets dissolved into that. So all that it can do is you can go approach nearer and nearer, and finally what will happen is that ocean will come and absorb you or completely take you inside. And at that point of time, if at all, you can use that word soham. Soham means he am I, ocean am I, I am the self. The soham is a very famous Vedantic term to indicate the oneness between individuality and the supreme. The statements like aham brahmasmi, tatvamasi are all famous mahavakyas which talk about the unity of jivatma and paramatma, that is the individual and the self. But this term soham is also a very famous statement or a famous phrase, you can say, which says he am I. That which is a supreme, that which is the ultimate he, who is beyond it all, who is the controller, who is the supreme God who maintains and controls this universe. In essence, now whatever is the essence of him, which is the Brahman, is the same Brahman I am, which I have realized. So that statement, soham asmi, soham, soham comes. Swami Ramtirtha uses this mantra, soham, to say it aloud. So that, he says, it forms part of your breathing exercise also. When you release the air and inhale the air, you will automatically say, soham, soham, like that, he says. So, when you are doing pranayama, when you are doing your breath, which is a continuous activity, he asks us to maintain this thought, that he am I, he am I. Because as far as we are concerned, now, God is he. He is somebody in a third person. He is supreme, somebody who is beyond it all, you know, like that. But the essence in him and the essence in me is one and the same, must be a practice. So, this he realizes and he says here. In this mantra, he addresses the sun god by various names, and sun is taken to be representative of the self here. He says, Pushan. Pushan means nourisher. The essential vitality to the world is provided by the sun. In fact, without sun, there is no activity. Rather, earth itself ceases to exist. All the living organisms ceases to exist. All the beings exist because food is there. Food is there because rain is there. Rain is there because the evaporation of water happens from sea and everything happens. All the activity, anything has happened only because sun is there. So, sun is the essential nourisher. Sun directly nourishes the plants, animals and humans also. So, sun is called as Pushan. Ekarshi. Ekarshi means soul traveler. It is there alone in the sky. Lone courser. Lone courser, at the same time, a witness of everything that is happening here. Witness, we use the term Sakshi in Sanskrit. The difference or the depth of the word Sakshi is, you know, it conveys a meaning much more than the word English witness. What is the difference?
So, witness is something more which is physical, when you see something which you don't feel. And Sakshi is also internal. You internalize something while you are watching, there is something which is more internal also. the combination of physical and internal.
See, the meaning of witness is that you are unconnected, you are disconnected. The moment you say internal, it has some connection inside, and it therefore there can be affectation also. But that defeats the very meaning of witness. Witness is you are unconnected, you are detached as it were. But there is a difference between witness and sakshi in a very subtle way, that's all. It's a, you can use the word witness by and large, that's not wrong. But sakshi is a better word to use. Sakshat ikshati, it is seeing, it's actually seeing. But what is the background from which it sees? That is the difference. Yes.
It is fully involved. It is because of the witness that it happens also.
Ha, in a way, right. So, the witness can be a third party who is unconnected to the whole incident at all. You know, so Swami Ramtirtha or somebody gives this example that when a person watches a marriage procession or a funeral procession from his terrace of his building, who has no connection. He is not connected to either the family where there is a marriage procession going, half an hour later a funeral procession is going, there is no connection. So he is a witness. He is not affected. He doesn't know who is getting married, why they are happy. He doesn't know who is dead and why they are sad. He is just witnessing. And both the processions were also waiting for sun above. Sun, we say, is sakshi, because both these processions cannot happen without sun. So sunlight is required for both the processions, yet it is totally disconnected from whatever is happening. That is called as sakshi. If you want to take it practically, suppose you say a person goes, you know, our Vedanta Academy is situated in Malavli, on the way to a tourist center also is there, or a Buddhist center, Karla Caves is there. Say if a person goes there and on the way he sees the academy and goes, and he sees it's a nice academy, he is just a witness to whatever is there. On the way back there is some incident in the academy, some building is broken or something, again he says, oh poor thing, and he goes. He is a witness to whatever has happened there. Sometimes the building is beautiful, sometimes it is not there. Both the cases, he is not affected, he is not connected, he is a witness. But how would, I am just giving it as an example, how would Swamiji view it? He has been instrumental in each and every brick and every grass of the academy. So whether it is running all right or whether it is broken, he is actually totally disconnected from the activities as it were. He will remain a sakshi. He has no affectations. But without him, the entire academy existence itself is not there now. So, such must be your attitude in life. It is objectivity. When we say objectivity, it must not be taken as a total sort of a indifference. It is not indifference. It is a disinterested interest. You are not affected by anything, but you are in it to fully make it happen also. You know, that sort of attitude is. So, sun, when we say, as a Ekarshi soul traveler, it is not that he is totally disconnected from the activities here. He is making everything happen, but anything that happens here cannot touch him in one way. So, he is all alone by himself there. That is the Ekarshi. Yama. Yama means controller. Everything with reference to world, as we said, is controlled by sun. Similarly, Brahman controls everything. All these parallels you will see in the sun. Nourisher, everything, the vitalities of the Atma from within. Ekarshi, Atman is all alone by itself. Sa Ekaha, says Veda, it is alone, it is one, it is without any second. And Yama, controller, exactly like how sun controls all the activities in the world. Brahman controls all the activities through the functioning of law of karma. Each and everything is controlled in a systematic and orderly way. Nothing goes out of way here or there. That is Yama. The relationship between microcosm, macrocosm, everything is very beautifully set. You cannot find any sort of a loophole or a discrepancy anywhere. It is perfectly matching everything. That is the control aspect. Surya. Surya means the sun who acquires everything, absorbs everything. It is the heat of the sun that absorbs everything. Exactly like that, this infinite self absorbs everything. We saw it, how it is in the... So, it is coming from the self, it exists on the self and everything merges back into self. Is that capacity of the self to infinite has that capacity to merge everything finite in it. Prajapatya, son of Prajapati, is the first manifestation of Brahman, is the sun god itself. That is why even in Gita, in the chronology of giving of this Brahma Vidya, Krishna says, I gave it to the sun god in the beginning. He was the first manifestation, as it were. So it is all in the beginning. So that anadi aspect is also a parallel to the sun. So we said that he is probably eulogizing sun because of various reasons. Obviously, sun is a very pratyaksha Brahman. That is, he is there as a Brahman which can be seen. Also, this Upanishad comes under the Yajurveda. For Yajnavalkya, sun god is also the guru. So that also could be a reason that he is eulogizing sun god. And then he is requesting the sun god to remove the disk, and he obliges. And the dazzle is too much for him to handle for a moment. And then he requests, gather up thy dazzle. Then I am able to now behold you. Sohamasmi, hi am I.
Sir.
Yes, sir.
So in Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna tells Arjuna that your last thought will decide your future birth.
Sorry?
Your last thought will decide your future birth. If you think of me, then you will come to me.
Correct.
We are even talking about a removal of the last thought.
Right.
So I don't even understand, sir.
Right. There's no contradiction. That whatever is your last thought, that is what you will, where you will go, is the formula, is the theorem. So therefore, the last thought here he is talking about, actually he is having the death of the ego itself. So this person is not going to have any future birth. The theorem is, once you are self-realized, that there is no future birth. So here it is dramatized that once you have, when we have lot of desires, and what will be our last thought? Usually it is the resultant of, by and large, what you have thought throughout the your lifetime. In your lifetime, if a person is more and more focused on money, etc., by and large, the resultant will be that it will be in that area, in that angle it will come, and he will be again born in somewhere where his material vasanas will take him. Similarly, in the 9th chapter only, I think, what we are chanting, he says, Deva Yanti... Devanyanti Devavrataha, Pitrunyanti Pitruvrataha. That is, whoever is worshipping gods, go to gods. Whoever is worshipping Pitrus, go to Pitrus. Whoever is worshipping the elements, go to elements. Matbhatya Yanti Mamapi. My devotees come to me. My devotees come to me. Here, what it represents is, a devotee is a person who is having, again in the same 9th chapter, he is saying Ananya Chinta. An unbroken thought flow towards the Lord. If he is having that unbroken thought flow towards the Lord, in and through, we saw how Vidya and Avidya can be combined, and throughout the life you are able to maintain that thought of the self, full probability is that in the last thought for you will be towards the God. So going to God is called as realization, as it were. So for all others whose karma is still remaining, and therefore their thoughts are going here or there, in which particular majority direction it will go, whatever is the resultant that it is going to take him, there he will go. So therefore, your next birth is determined by that. Again, you have a chance to, when you are in a human birth, you have a chance to think of God, etc. So here he has understood the purpose of life, made all the efforts to remove all thoughts pertaining to the world in whichever direction they may be. So all the thoughts are finally culminated in this thought of the self. That thought of the self is the last thing that has to be removed. That removal is not in our hands. So he says, remove that thought. So here he is dramatizing what is known as the death of ego. The ego or individuality which is hanging by the last thought of the self has to be removed. That's what it means.
So I'm not understanding. So I hear that in Gita he says, the last thought will take you to me.
Last thought, if it is a madbhaktya yanti mamapi, not everybody's last thought, if it is on God, it will take you to God. As simple as that. Whichever is your last thought, there you will go. But that last thought is not live whatever way you want throughout your life, and suddenly the last thought will not come like that.
So that is clear, but here he is talking about removal of the last thought. So that is what I am not being able to understand.
Correct. Removal of the... See, last thought is not the thought before the time of your death. That your thought is still there. There is a lot of stock of thought still there. The thought during your lifetime in this Janma you are talking about. He is not talking about that. He has finished all the possibilities of thought. Self-realization is defined as thoughtlessness. God is equal to man minus desires. So all the desires which are preoccupying, he has systematically removed all the desires. He has scientifically removed by various practices of karma, bhakti, jnana, everything is removed. Now he has brought himself like the essence of the last butter which is there at the top. The essence of all the milk is the butter that is floating on the top now. That removal he is commanding that he must do it. So that is called as self-realization. That's why I said this has nothing or no parallel to any of our experiences. So we cannot understand what he is talking about. He is dramatizing what self-realization is. Self-realization is actually amani bhava, a state where there is no mind, where there is no thought. Somewhat equivalent to that is what you can think of yourself during deep sleep. Actually you are in that state. But we are in a totally ignorant condition where we do not know what we are. That is why we even talk about sleep after we get up only. That it was a very sound sleep or something like that. But while in that stage we are not aware. That stage, because all our awareness are centered around thought only. Now here he is talking about a state of pure awareness where there is no scope of thought. So that last thought, which is the last bridge to cross over from finite to infinite, that he is wanting to remove. O son, soul traveler, controller, acquirer, son of Prajapati, do remove thy rays and gather up thy dazzle. I behold that form of thine, that being, that is most auspicious. He am I. We'll chant mantra 17 twice.
वायुरनिलम अमृतमथेदम भस्मान्तकं शरीरम् ॐ क्रतो स्मर कृतगो स्मर क्रतो स्मर कृतगो स्मर वायुरनिलम अमृतमथेदम भस्मान्तकं शरीरम् ॐ क्रतो स्मर कृतगो स्मर क्रतो स्मर कृतगो स्मर.
Now this breath be returned to immortal air, this body be reduced to ashes. Om, O mind, remember what has been done, remember. O mind, remember what has been done, remember. It's a very inspiring mantra. In a way you can say this is a last mantra for this Ishavasya, but the real last mantra is the next mantra only. We find a repetition here. In Keno Upanishad also, in the last mantra we saw a repetition. It's one way of indicating that the knowledge aspect of it is coming to an end. And 18th mantra is a beautiful prayer. This mantra is talking about the physical death of a self-realized person. 15, 16 and 17 form a thought flow. And it is in a sequence. In 15, he is in the verge of realization. In 16th is actual realization. And in 17th mantra, what is indicated here is the Mahasamadhi or the physical death of that person. So he is writing a will as it were. In this will we see a complete sense of letting go or renunciation. There is absolutely no arrogation, which this mantra only has to be felt more rather than understood. See, he says, may the breath merge with the immortal air. To the elements in the nascent form. Similarly, the body be reduced to ashes. I think in the book of, what is it called? They talk about ashes to ashes, dust to dust.
Dust to dust, dust to dust. Was not spoken of there.
Something they do it in.
Spoken of this whole.
It is in the funeral that they read that, right? It is exactly the same parallel, maybe taken from here, I don't know, that he says, see, what is inspiring us, he is writing the will while he is as as he is leaving the body, there is an aspect of the elements. See, all the elements in the world, the Panchabhuta which it is made up of, it is there actually inseparable from each other. But because of our ego, we are believing that we have acquired some aspect of it and give it a form and a shape and believing ourselves to be that. We claim that it is my body. When you say my body, it is my space that I occupy. See, what is it that my space that I occupy? See, imagine you are going in a car from here to your home or your some other city, Jamshedpur, you go. As and where the car is going, it is occupying that space and that space must belong to that car. If anybody impinges upon that space or encroaches that space, what happens? There is an accident which you are not ready to take. So, what do we do? Take it from a very practical point of view. Even when a mosquito bites or ant bites, immediate reflex of our body is to hit it, kill it, or do whatever you do, because it is encroaching into my space. What I consider it is mine. But if you take a little bit broader outlook, even science proves it, everybody knows that each and every aspect of your body that has been created is not really yours. This body is created by the food consumed by your parents. They come together, then it is formed, then it is grown by the food. So therefore, your body has element of the body of the rice, of the fish, of whatever you eat. That is all part of your body. But we say, this is my body. Like that, if you take into consideration each and every aspect of our personality, be it breath, be it body, be your mind also, each and everything literally does not belong to us in terms of claiming my body or my prana or my mind. Even the air we breathe, unless the oxygen is released by the tree, we are not going to intake this. So your carbon dioxide is part of the tree. The tree's oxygen is part of all the animals and you. So there is actually no boundary can be drawn anywhere. But it is our foolish notion of ego that we say, this is me. It belongs to me. My body. Like that we say. So now he is very, obviously he has lived a life and he has now realized the self and he is absolutely detached. So now he says, that which I have been arrogating all this while as mine, let it now merge with the totality. What you claim as yours is nothing but a very small speck of what the total thing is. All the elements in their pure and natural form, they are there as it is. From there, what is created is this body, which is made up of the same five elements. That is why in death we say that you know that the fire element was there, you know that the air element was there, all that is gone in the death. Till that last moment we try to hold on, but it invariably escapes. But then what happens? You go into next body and your journey continues. Now, as far as this person is concerned, his ego is completely dissolved. He is carrying that baggage of the body all this while for some more time. And now it is for him to release that baggage also. So he very clearly says, what I have considered to be mine as my body all along, let it now merge with that totality. My air, let it go to that immortal air, that total air. Let my body be burned to ashes. Literally, with reference to physical body, it is said that it has no value at all as far as human body is concerned, vis-a-vis other animals, tiger's body or elephant's ivory and every aspect of the elephant, each and everything is invaluable. Now I do not know, we can say transplantation and all happens, we do not know what is the price of a heart or a kidney, it may be much more if you have maintained it properly. But compared to all other things, it is worthless. It is worthless. It is just a rented house that we are staying in and you have to finish it and go. So this, but if you see how disproportionately we are trying to spend time on it, nourish it in terms of what we are talking about is a body consciousness. We do not consider ourselves beyond this body. So the time and attention that we give to honoring this, you have to just maintain the body just as you will maintain a car so that your travel doesn't get affected. That's all. That must be the respect given. It houses the Atma, so the body is having respect or value because of the Atma inside. That must be the relation to the body. But we give disproportionate value to that. So that is all completely demolished here. He says, let it now merge back to that total air. Let the body be burnt to ashes. So he is covering the Annamaya Kosha by saying that let the body be burnt to ashes. Let the air merge with the total air. It's the Pranamaya Kosha. The second line can be taken as covering of mind and intellectual sheath in a way, or repetition it can be taken. What he is saying is, oh mind, remember what has been done. Om. Om represents the state of self which he has realized in the previous mantra, it is indicated. So, finally he concludes, Om. Om is the Supreme Brahman. O mind, remember that. Remember that. What he means is, O mind, I have already dealt with you. Remember that. What you have to remember? All along what you have been remembering. All along the mind has been remembering the self. Therefore, it has merged with the self. Therefore, I have nothing more to deal with you. You remember that. You remember that self. You remember that self. So, it is repeated to emphasize on that. Again, you can say it is repeated to emphasize about mind and intellect. Because we see until the realization, the mind and intellect have a separate existence. Again, in the drama of realization which is there in Bhagavad Gita, as long as the last thought is remaining, both mind and intellect are remaining. Upon realization, both mind and intellect both go. Mind goes because thought flow ceases, intellect goes because all the pairs of opposites cease to exist. So there is an absolute vacuum there, as it were. Mind and intellect are totally absorbed into it. All this he has dealt along the sadhana which culminated in realization. So the thought of the self which he has been carrying so far, remember that. Om, remember that. Remember that self. Remember that self. That's all. So even as the person who has lived, so in other words, a person who has lived a life thinking about the self and who has realized the self, suddenly after realization he will not think, my prarabdha vasanas are remaining, let me enjoy the world. This type of thought will not come to him. All along what he has been living, that is what he will continue later also. Therefore, even as his body is continuing with the mind, that whatever is the prarabdha mind that is continuing, it will be only completely covered with the thought of the self. So he says, remember that, twice to indicate this. Now, this mantra gives the idea of what is known as Mahasamadhi. Mahasamadhi means absolute realization. Not absolute realization. It is the physical death of a realized person. That is called as Mahasamadhi. We say the such and such saint attained Mahasamadhi. We don't say he died or not. It is not a proper usage. Of course, in English you can use the word death or died. But when we talk about a great saint, we say he attained. Swami Ramtirtha attained Mahasamadhi. We don't say he drowned in Ganga or something like that. Actually, he did not. What we say about Swami Ramtirtha or any great saint is that he attained Mahasamadhi. Mahasamadhi means it is a physical death of a realized person. So therefore, it indicates that a person can be alive after realization. This is called as Jivan Mukta. This we dealt in detail when we studied the Tattva Bodha, I don't know, a year back or something. Mukti or liberation can be attained while you are living here is the declaration of the Vedas through various statements. And also the living experiences of various masters. But one set of people say, however much you try also, you can go up to there and still fall a little short of it, and the ultimate realization happens, liberation happens after your death only. This is another school of thought. So they talk about Jivan Mukti versus Videha Mukti. Videha Mukti means Deha is a body. So the Mukti happens after the physical death only. So that means actual liberation is when you go and merge into God somewhere, you know, that sort of an idea. These are also carried by various schools of thought. within Vedanta itself, within Hinduism itself. All this is a very fine point of distinction at the very ultimate level. By and large, all the schools of thought agree with Vedas and 99% of all the statements and karma and everything. These are certain subtle philosophic discussions and demarcations at the very highest level. What is Jiva? Finally, whether the Jiva is part of Brahman or it actually merges into Brahman and it has no existence thereafter at all. These are various schools of thought, and therefore in Vedanta you have Dvaita, Vishishta Advaita, Advaita, Veda, Veda, various many schools and various many propounders are there. What we have to really understand here is, whatever any master may say with reference to any school of thought, including Advaitic philosophy, as far as we are concerned, it is all intellectual concepts. You cannot establish truth by intellect. This is very clear. This must be very clear. If a person is able to convince you with his, all his scientific arguments and he is able to establish a particular philosophy, you will be convinced. But if a superior intellect than him comes and argues in a different way and he establishes that, that will be established. Okay. If Adi Shankaracharya established Advaita philosophy, he did not start this. It was there. He re-established and brought everything under the umbrella of Advaita and we follow that only. If that was the case, after Adi Shankaracharya established everything, then Ramanujacharya should not have come at all with his re-establishing what is known as a Vishishta Advaita. But he did it. And he gave all the arguments for this, etc. And he did that. After that, Madhvacharya came. After that, Samadhara Acharya came. So, this is the beauty of our religion or Hinduism, that it gives a varied, a existence of various schools of thought, like a banyan tree with various branches and various prop roots, it's there, not like a coconut tree that is only one God and one way and one surrender, it's not like that. And this has given rise to a lot of thinking and reflection. So this is essential part of our Vedantic study also. But it should not be merely stopped at the intellectual discussions alone. This must be very clear. So unless otherwise we get there, we are not going to know what it is exactly. But one powerful argument given on the side of the Jivan Muktas is that if a person cannot realize during his lifetime, then all the scriptures and all the revelations, as it were, that he gets in the state of samadhi, we cannot take it as inspired words, but just not imagination, but a deep thinking or reflection out of a result of which all this has come. Now, when you even read a book of Ramtirtha, it is not that you understand it merely at the intellect level, it vibrates in you if you get into that frequency that people would have experienced it. And these are collection of just his lectures. He has not written a book, but the state in which he gave that lectures, that has been faithfully taken down, and that we are reading 100 years later, that itself produces an effect. Now you can imagine the statements of Vedas and Upanishads that are coming from the masters through a state of self-absorption. So that is why we don't say they are the authors of the Upanishad, they are not the authors of any mantras. They are called as mantra drashtas. They have seen the mantras, as it were, in that state. It has been revealed through them. See, there is a way by which there is a way of inventing something where your knowledge is expanded to create something. Okay, we say invention of aeroplane. But we say discovery of a particular law. So what is the difference between invention and discovery?
Invention, you create it, and then discovery, it was already there.
Correct. So it's already there that you find it out now. But invention you create, but out of what?
An existing law.
An existing law and the material. See, if you say Wright brothers invented aeroplane. Existing laws, etc., they understood, and they also found out the materials, etc., to make it, but for the purpose of flying. So, discovery is something that you are able to see the effect and you want to know the cause for it. You dig deep and know the cause, that is discovery. The cause is there. Law of gravitation, we say, can be discovered. The effect is falling of apple, cause is law of gravitation, that is discovered. But we say aeroplane is invented because for a desired effect, you use the cause. The desired effect is I want to fly, so I invent a aeroplane. The desired effect is I have to cook faster, therefore it necessitates me to invent a pressure cooker. These are all how new knowledges are coming. But apart from these two, we also see something known as a revelation. That revelation is nothing to do with either invention or discovery in the same way that we understand understanding of knowledge. Revelation is in some deep thought of self-absorption, certain things that is flowing through you. Great Indian scientists like Jagadish Chandra Bose and mathematicians like Ramanujam, they talk about their formulas being given to them by the goddess. Ramanuja, their deity in their village is Lakshmi. Her name I forgot, but she is goddess Lakshmi. And he says all the formula, which 100 years later they are still trying to come in terms with his formula, he doesn't arrogate it to himself because it is a fact that in that some state it was revealed to him. So it is not only Upanishad that we are talking about. So in the good old days, how did they know all the Ayurveda and yoga and everything, every each and every aspect of how your body functions? They did not cut open the body to see as we are experimenting now and seeing, but they knew and wrote down all the necessary things that are required for that. How did they know? It is all through some revelation, some deep concentration and something which has revealed through them. It is. So, if we only accept Jivan Mukti, then we can really revel in the power of these mantras. Otherwise, as we say, it will be an intellectual study of the Upanishads. You will not feel the same vibration when you study a Bhagavad Gita or Upanishad or anything, because it is not coming from the master and through his intellect. That is why even in the Upanishads, not as just a word of humility, he says, it's a genuine thing that iti shushruma purvesham yenastar vichar. We have heard it from our masters. It could be a just a original idea coming through him. But he genuinely says that because it really does not belong to him. That is not his belief, that is a fact. That is a fact that he knows. So, when Shukacharya gives Bhagavat the story, a person who is in a self-absorbed state always, he is talking about Krishna, he is talking about certain stories. Certain stories come through his mouth where his eyes are closed, he doesn't know who the audience is. In certain stories, like he is very involved and he is telling the king and he is enjoying saying that story. So, where does that story come and how does it come? How did Valmiki get the full picture of Ramayana or something? So, there is something which is beyond, but they are still in their living state. So, Jivan Mukta is a state where a person is living and he has realized the self while living. Then what happens to the stage of post-realization till his physical death? This is explained for those who are not, who want as an intellectual concept, by the concept of prarabdha vasanas. Prarabdha vasanas or prarabdha karma is the set of vasanas that we are born with. Each and every creature is born with certain vasanas which needs fructification, which needs immediate experience. It has matured to that extent that it needs a embodiment, it needs an environment to express itself. It cannot be taken back, as it were. So that prarabdha vasanas will carry on in your life. What you meet in life, therefore, is your prarabdha. It is all set, as it were, set not by some god independent of you. It is according to your karma, you earned for it and you have got it. And that will continue till your death. But when a man is born, or a human being is born, he has a distinct quality separate from the animals that he can deal with his what is known as Sanchita Vasana. Sanchita Vasana is the stock or total vasanas. Sanchita means what is acquired, what is collected. You have collected lots and lots of vasanas from Janmas together. It is there lying in stock. out of which some have fructified into this form of prarabdha, which needs immediate fructification. But being in this human form, you can practice the knowledge of the self by which those vasanas get burnt in that form and they will not further germinate at all. When the entire stock of sanchita is burnt, that state is called as self-realization. So therefore, there is no cause for you to take future birth. So therefore, what happens to the prarabdha? Prarabdha you have to go through. That is why we see even some saintly persons, certain self-realized masters, they have to go through certain physical trouble also. From our point, it's a physical trouble. But as far as they are concerned, the moment you are realized, like the person here who writes the will, they are completely detached from the body. They may have from apparently a cancer or any other disease also, but they, as far as they are concerned, they are not the body. Body is like a shadow. When you are walking on the road, your shadow falls on the grass on the side, or a rose garden on the side, or sometimes in the gutter. All along we have been thinking that we are the shadow, so when it is on the rose garden we are elated, when it is in the gutter we are suffering. This is what we have done. Suddenly we realize we are not the shadow, we are the person who is standing and going. Now what is your relation to the shadow? It is just something coming along. Like that is their attitude, that something is coming along. That is the body. So that body will go through certain things, they have no connection to it. But that body has to complete its course. That is why you will find certain people living in opulence throughout. That is all there. You know, even if you try to take away from him, somehow or the other it will come. They are meant to live like that. Some people, however much people may give money and this and that, they cannot retain money and they have to be in abject poverty always. Like that it is. It's all meant to be like that. We have said this story before that there is a Ranganatha Goswami who is a disciple of Samartha Ramadas. Samartha Ramadas is the guru of Shivaji. So Ranganatha Goswami, who was also a great renunciate, who was a Shishya and among various Shishyas there, but his life was always like in opulence. There used to be always cushions for him, there used to be bodyguards, there used to be somebody fanning, everything was there available for him. And as though like outwardly like a bogey's life only he was living. But his master knew his state and there was nothing that he had any problem. But other Shishyas could not understand and they are complaining, saying that a life of a renunciate doesn't gel with this. You know, a life of a renunciate which is absolute necessity with one cloth or with bhiksha, this is what he has to be. And why is he living like this? They are not able to understand, so they complain. So just to clear their thing, he said to Ranganatha Goswami that why do you want all this luxuries? Just give them away. Just be with one cowpeen, whatever you are supposed to be. And why don't you be like us all, he said. Whatever Guru said, he immediately followed. And as a team, they were supposed to go to the next village for bhiksha. Because Sannyasa Ashrama has this right to take bhiksha and eat. They have to sustain their body. Bhiksha is what you get as alms from the householders and eat. So Ranganatha Goswami was also about to go with them. He said, you sit here only. And they went. When they went into the forest, he was just sitting under the tree and doing whatever he was doing. Shivaji Maharaj came with his entourage to hunt. And suddenly he saw Ranganatha Goswami there. He immediately brought in fruits. He immediately brought in all the servants and bodyguards. He put a shamiana there. And again they were doing all the comfort. When they all returned, they saw this is happening. He said, what has happened? This is what happened. Shivaji Maharaj came. So this is what he was telling his disciples. He is meant, his body is meant to live like that in a luxury. Somebody is meant to, even if they don't have a car, everywhere they will travel in a car. They are like that. It is what is meant for them. It's certain thing that is acquired by their past karma. It is called as prarabdha vasana. So by and large, we relate it to how your body is structured. What is your good part of your swadharma. So certain people who sing Tyagaraja, he will continue to sing. After this realization also he will sing. Somebody will continue to talk. Somebody will continue to write. Ramana Maharshi, whatever it is, he was continuing to remain silent. So we can only understand what their prarabdha from their, how they live post-realization. Again, this concept of prarabdha vasana is only for understanding how the jnanis live post-realization. Though we also have our prarabdha vasanas, as far as we are concerned, Every vasana must be treated as a vasana and you have to get over it. Otherwise, why are you smoking? Means you say it's my prarabdha vasana, I can't do it. You have to get over the smoking. You have to get over all your negativities. So you consider every vasana to be a vasana, something that you need to fight and get over. Vasana means a urge, a desire. So mind, when it is urging you to do something, you have to fight it over. Meaning it should not command by itself. If you are doing certain things out of your intellectual sanction, that is what we recommend. Therefore, you need to fight it out, and then you can classify vasanas. So how you must deal with nishiddha karma or a kamya karma, or how you have to go through certain with experience. That is all classification and analysis with intellect, and you can model your life accordingly. But a concept of prarabdha vasana is for us to understand that it is mainly to understand the life of an enlightened soul. For that only. The segregation can be very clear only after realization. As far as we are concerned, if you work on certain things, that gets added to your stock, and when it fructifies, that will force you to take the next janma. So why do you want that? You cannot know, and you really do not know what is the total stock now, whether it is too much or infinite or in what form it is. None of it is accessible to us because vasanas is something inconceivable. So we can only work in terms of what is our thought, what is our desire, how should we deal with it, and how do we orient our thoughts towards the self. The agami vasanas, which are the yet to come in his lifetime of a jnani, they also do not touch him. The results of those actions do not also touch him. But the prarabdha he has to go through as a experience. This is what is given. In our academy, agami vasanas is given as an equation of sanchita minus prarabdha. But in Tattvabodha, it is given in a slightly different way. That's why I say it's a matter of a very subtle understanding of this vasanas. But what we understand is, from our standpoint, he is living in the world, and what is being done through him will be in the service of the world in whichever ways. He could be a silent Swami like Ramana Maharshi, or like a Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, or like Saint Tyagaraja, or like Ramatirtha. The expressions all can be different. But essentially, as it were, they are placed amidst us for us to get inspired. If such persons are not there, the living tradition of that a person can realize the self will be totally lost for us. And it is by their association that others can elevate themselves. So when they go out of the scene, that vacuum is created by where somebody else fills it. So it is a living tradition of realized masters is as though a leela of God itself for us to continue on this line. If such masters were, if Ramatirtha was not there, I am talking about modern times, Ramana Maharshi was not there, if Paramahamsa was not there, the concept of self-realization would not be understood. Just by having all the material stored in a Google or a book and you read about it, you are not going to get anything. Unless otherwise a living master is there in front of you. So probably it is the leela that immediately after realization, if they have to vanish into thin air, and we will be at loss. So it is God's will, as it were, that they are kept for humanity to go further. This is the thing. And once the prarabdha vasanas are also exhausted, their life also comes to an end. This is the theory. But as long as they are living in this body, their movement is equated to a car which is running at a great speed, but in which the engine is turned off. From outside point of view, you see a car, you see a driver, therefore you conclude that he is driving the car. But that is not so. He is not driving the car. The car is moving at a purva adhyasa, means a past force. If the car is switched off at 60 kilometers an hour, it will go in a certain force. If the car is switched off in 120 kilometers an hour, it will go in a greater force and it will go for a longer time. But it will go and stop somewhere. So the engine turned off is the point of self-realization. And where the car stops is the point of Mahasamadhi. The life between that is the running of the car between those two points is the life of a realized soul according to the Prarabdha Vasanas. Another example that is given is, you have a ulcer or a wound in the body, the skin, and it heals after a while. It heals maybe after a week or so. A thin crust is formed on that. So when the crust is formed, you know internally that it is cured. But if you try to peel off the crust, it will reopen the wound again. So it is not advised. But the crust will fall in its own time. It may be one day, it may be 2 days, it will fall off. So internally it is completely cured, but the crust to fall, it will take time. So internally the mind and intellect has merged with the self. Realization is over. But this body is like a covering which will take its own time to go. That period is called as Prarabdha Vasanas. So this person has realized the self and he is writing the will where he is going to attain Mahasamadhi. That is the life of a Jivan Mukta according to his Prarabdha Vasanas. Yes, sir.
Sir, on this question of oh mind remember, it is almost like on one hand we are talking about the mind extinguishing itself, okay, and the self-realization, but this sort of gives you a sense that mind will continue to exist. It gives you that kind of a feel, this statement, so that is a little confusing.
Yeah, as long as the body is functioning as you see, from your point, as the body is functioning, the mind and intellect within him also will also function. So that person will also think and do certain things. So for all practical purposes, you take the vasanas is expressing itself as body, mind and intellect and continuing to function. But the mind, because of its practice of thinking of the self throughout, now also is reiterating that thought, think of that. And I have already dealt with you in terms of your realization. That's all it says. So mind, in other words, it has not a propelling power to have a desire for this or that anymore. That propelling self-effort force is not there. Just as a rain clouds are have no choice but to go into a low pressure area and release themselves as rain, which will benefit the earth. These people are forced to do certain things by the mahat of that situation and they will continue. When they continue, their body, mind, intellect, all three continues to function. That's about all.
So mind will continue even after self-realization in this body?
Yes, when you understand in the context of what we explain as mind. When the body continues, mind will continue, as simple as that. Okay. It's not a robo. He is a very, very much a living entity as far as we are concerned. As far as he is concerned, he is totally detached from the body, mind and intellect. They are not his, they are not just, it is not that. From our point of view,
state of mind has changed.
Mind itself is not there as far as he is concerned. That what you call as my mind is not there, just as my body is not there. But just as the body continues to function, his mind continues to function.
Sir, now if Prarabdha Vasanas are a part of Sanchita Vasanas, right?
Okay.
So we are saying that with the tapas in this life, we can get over our Sanchita Vasanas. Now, Prarabdha Vasanas being part of Sanchita Vasanas, why are they not extinguished at the same time?
See, the thing is, Prarabdha were part of the Sanchita, but once it has fructified and come out, they have an independent thing. So that's why when we draw this diagram, you say, of course, this is just indicative that this is the totality Sanchita, out of which one portion, Prarabdha, which needs immediate fructification, has popped out as it were. This popped out thing is your embodiment and environment that you are born. That is your Prarabdha. So once it has fructified, that means the results has started pouring in. Once it has started yielding results, then once the arrow has left, bullet has left the barrel, there is no way that it can be taken back. It has to go and hit. So, but you can deal with the rest of the thing by your knowledge of the self. In that same form, whatever, in whichever way they are, they can be burnt completely. That is possible. But this Prarabdha, you have to go through. Another example is given that a mother wants to feed the child. In Indian way, you know that she has the total thing to feed it in a big bowl there. Out of that bowl, she takes something in the plate. And in that plate, she mixes with the dal some portion, and yes, she escaped some portion because from time to time she will mix it and with the doll and give. At some point of time, the child says full and no more. So the mother says, okay, I am not going to touch anything in that bowl that is not there at all. Even this portion which I have not yet mixed, you need not have. But this one you have to have, she says. The totality in the bowl is Sanchita. That which has come into the plate is the Prarabdha, which she has mixed, that she has to go through. What is in the future for that mixing I will not take, that is the Agami Vasana, that I will not touch it. But what has been already mixed, you have to finish it. The child says no more because it has become Paripurna. Paripurna means full. That Paripurna is the state of the self. So that which has come out of it, having come out of it, we don't relate it to Sanchita. So a tiger or any other animal which is living through its Prarabdha, we say it goes through its Prarabdha. That's all. It cannot deal with the Sanchita in any way. After death, whatever is the next powerful that will carry on, this is the way it is explained. But a human being can deal, and in this Janma you can create new vasanas also, totally unconnected also you can do. See, by and large there are various forces which will not allow you to devolve, and you will not be allowed to do that. But if you put in special effort, you can do. And that what will happen, it becomes addition to that Sanchita, and if you work on it more and more, that will become powerful, that will create the future embodiment. That will, if you think about it, reconcile easily with what, where your last thought will take you. It will, next Janma it will take you, because you are working on it and making it fructify actually. So therefore, this Prarabdha which has come out is not. So therefore, knowledge can wipe out Sanchita. Experience alone can wipe out Prarabdha. Wipe out means you have to go through. It's not wiping out in terms of burning. You have to go through it.
Sir, what is the relation? I generally understand, but I'm getting a little confused. What is the relation of Prarabdha Vasana, if we take a look at it as a cause and effect, can we look at it in that sense, that the cause has initiated and the effect will come?
Effect is the Prarabdha Vasana. Effect is your embodiment. Effect is all the that you go through. The cause has been already done.
Then why does Sanchita not have the same?
You have not put in so much power. Vasanas are still waiting to fructify. So they will, in due course of time, that will also fructify. They have to have a conducive environment to come, and for which you are working on the vasana, that will also come later on.
Oh, so what you are saying in effect is that the Prarabdha Vasanas we have worked so much on that they have to fructify in a certain way, maybe more in a more manifesting way. But Sanchita Vasana we can just internalize and make effect, do some, so they can get extinguished without. Very large.
Correct. Without their manifestation, you can deal it there itself. And that is through knowledge of the self. Through the thought of Aham Brahmasmi, through the thought of I am the self, you can wipe away all. Go back and revise that portion on Tattva Bodha. It very clearly defines as to what these three vasanas are and what is their nature and how they can be extinguished. Yes.
Sir, I am confused about Agami Vasanas. When you say Agami means Sanchita minus Prarabdha. But a self-realized person has
burnt
all his
sanctity.
So then there is...
There's no... In this formula, there's no. Agami is given for us only. So whatever has come out, the remaining thing is Agami, is what Swamiji has also explained to us. But what is explained in the Tattva Bodha is that as such, it is very difficult to understand. Even while explaining, we said even we are not fully clear as to what it is. There are certain actions that get initiated, and every action will have its own effect. But the effect of that action, whether it is papa, punya, etc., are not having any impact on as far as the self-realized person is concerned. See, that's why in that time I think we gave an example of how, of course, Balarama we consider as avatar. But assume him to be a very evolved person or a realized person also. He goes and unnecessarily kills a person, and he himself takes a penance and goes through prayaschitta karma also for it. Suppose certain things get done as karma through you. Now you are also thinking and doing certain things. But the effects of this, which has potential to manifest later as a result of that action, those things are not going to touch you. So the question arises then, what happens to such karma? So he says all the punya karma of a jnani goes to him who praises him. All the papa karma, as it were, we don't see him, it will go to him who is abusing him. Suppose if a person is abusing a self-realized person, he is going to unnecessarily gather on the papa of it. So this is explained as an agami there. If you ask me 100%, I am also fully not clear as to it. But this is the expression.
It's more or less the karma you have done in this lifetime.
It is not karma you have done in this lifetime. That you will do now and it will fructify later. Or it can be. But as far as you are concerned, the effect of all the karma you have burnt. So you are as though completely disassociated from it. But the karma which has been done and which will have its own course or its own effect have no bearing on this person as it were.
Which means the karma you have done after self-realization as a
jivatma. Or the effects of those karma which is going to come to you after being a jivanmukta. That is not going to touch you at all. That's all.
The second line. What is the purpose of it? The repetition apart. Oh mind, think of the good deeds that I have done. Then in that sense, that's why.
It's not that, think of the good deeds. It says, mind, remember what has been done. Yes, in many interpretations, it is said about the good deeds I have done. The real good deed the mind has done is to remember the self. So even at the time of the realization, it's saying, remember that. And he's saying, as he has dealt with the body and breath and other things, he's saying, remember, I have already dealt with you. Dealt with you in the sense, you have been already dissolved into it. So there is nothing more to be done. So it is a very beautiful way of saying that, remember the self. That's why Om is given before. Om. Kratosmara kritagum smara. Kratosmara kritagum smara.
So, Mahabhuta is already dealt with and the third one he has no dealing.
Yes, he has no dealing. So in terms of Annamaya, Pranamaya, Manomaya, Vijnanamaya, everything is done. Anandamaya has no special thing because there is no direct dealing with it. When every other manifestation goes, that also automatically goes. So it is a very clear case of complete merger of the personality of all the koshas with the totality. So that is why it is given. We'll conclude with the bhajans here.
Giridhari, Giridhari, Jaya. Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.